me tell you my little story about Sally Stanfield. I went to a talk that she gave a few months back in my suburban slash rural county, and she was giving a talk on guardianship, and I said, well, this is something I don't know enough about. I'm a doctor, not a lawyer. I don't understand these things. And she was able to boil it down to a level that for me was very informative and helpful and understandable. And this was a day when the weather wasn't so good. She'd had a flat tire. She was late getting there because of that. And yet she recovered her composure very quickly and was able to go through this. And I can just tell you, as someone who goes around and speaks at things, it is not easy when you are sort of off your game and something's happened that you can go out and just sort of pick up the pieces and do a good job. And it was obvious from her talk that not only is she knowledgeable, but she's a person who is sincere and genuine and committed. In her practice of law, what she largely does is things like guardianship and advocacy for children and people with disabilities. So she has experience in our area, and this is a really important topic. And it's one of those things that can sneak up on you because we're doing all this crazy stuff with the day-to-day, and all of a sudden your kid's about to turn 18. And then there's a whole set of very important and complex legal issues which come into play. So I think this is a really important topic and something that'll be really informative. I think you will enjoy her talk. So this is Sally Stanfield.
Thank you, Scott.
Advance, go back, and little red button is the pointer.
Oh, that's really good. Advance. You need that. Thanks.
Fancy government laptop.
I'm telling you. So the other part of the story is I walk in and I don't have my jacket on. It was raining. We got through it. Traffic was horrible. One of the organizers for the conference was kind enough to come get me. So there's Scott and many in the audience. And truly, it's what led to today. And I just want to let you all know what a pleasure it is for me to be here, a real privilege. I met a family just a couple of minutes ago, and it was a nice segue from the drive I had in this morning. I grew up on a farm. We still farm about 20 miles from here. And while I can only say I've learned a lot from all the families I've worked with over the years, I can tell you that having grown up on a farm, it's a different way to think. It's a 24/7. You roll from struggle to crisis. And for that, I'm grateful because I do have a little better understanding. But yet, on the other hand, I don't live in your shoes, and I know you have your hands full. So for me to be able to be here today, provide information, provide you with a path, provide you with resources that you may or may not have had, is a real pleasure for me. And I want to tell you that although I'm going to give you the disclaimer that this is not legal advice, at the end of the day, and you're from all parts of the country, you're welcome to contact me because there is a certain general piece to all of this that is very transportable. And I really appreciate the fact that Scott and Jennifer have asked me here today. So I want you to be able to take this back to your respective states and know that with the power of the internet and the other resources that you can find specifically from today, that you can get to the information, that you can be alert to the fact that when your child turns 18, there's going to be an automatic barrier there that says you can't make appointments for your child. You can't pick up your child's mail and open it up. You can't sign off on behalf of your child. You can't, there will be some level of tax filing that's required, you can't sign off on that. You can't get into your child's medical records. If your child's still in a public school program, wherever that is, until age 21 through that school year, the schools are probably going to be okay with your continuing on the IEP process. However, maybe not. And your medical practitioners, they may or may not honor the fact that you're a parent, you're a guardian, you're a caregiver through that age of 21 when that child's able to stay in the school system. So by planning ahead, that's what I want to leave you with. And I made up a word which people who've known me for more than a few minutes realize. I'm good at making up stuff called aphorisms because that's my dad. He's the guy who said, don't burn daylight. None of you burn daylight because you're on 24/7. So being planful, planful. It's a word I made up, but it works. So what I want to leave you with is knowledge that will serve you going down the road. I want to start, and let me back up with one more thing. The resilience that you all have, I can't say enough about. I walked in this morning, I met Melissa, Scott, Steve, thank you, middle-aged moment. But the fact that you're here, you're out of bed. I walk in this morning, it's evident. The passion, the compassion, the love, the resilience, the strength. And that is the reason I'm here, so you all leave with information. The reason I want to start with transition planning, free appropriate public education called FAPE, is that under federal law, your children at age 14, Maryland's one of those states that has, or excuse me, 16 on federal law, 14 in Maryland and other states, where everything about that individualized education plan is geared towards getting the student ready for exit from high school. So when you're in your individual states, the grand scheme of free appropriate public education is going to be the same under federal law, and then the state's going to tweak it. But everything matters. It's preparation for life after high school. It's vocational skills. It's those skills that enable your children to be whatever level of independence that they can achieve. It's being able to communicate. We're human. Whether we have oral language or not, we have communication in our heads. And to not be able to communicate basic needs. I'm thirsty. I need a restroom. I'm hungry. I want a hug. I want a reason to get up in the morning. So that is, in fact, the skills of independent living that are very important for transition planning. So for those of you, and understand most of you have your kiddos between like 6 and 12 years of age. We have some who are up to public school age and then some others who are over 21. But this is the transition planning that guides everything you ought to be thinking about. So you're already in the world of assessments, evaluations, physicians, social workers, every manner of specialist you can think of. How many have still children in school? Most everybody I see, yes. So you're going to be thinking about all this every day, every week, every month. But as your child gets closer to 18, and especially by age 14, if you're in Maryland, at least 16 under federal law, you want to make sure that you've got everything up to date so that when your child leaves the school system, you've got a document that will carry you forward to your agencies that you're working with. And even though the PowerPoints that you have is geared toward Maryland, every state's going to have something akin to our Developmental Disabilities Administration, DDA. And that will be an agency that serves with resources and funding, doesn't actually provide the services, but resources and funding for the services that your children need from the time of leaving high school going forward. You're going to have through your high school, your state departments of education, a Department of Rehabilitation Services here in Maryland, DORS, D-O-R-S, Department of Rehab Services is the moniker of the acronym DORS. DHMH, you're going to have that in your own state. It's health and mental hygiene. So these are all systems that, unlike your high school services under your IEP, are there as a matter of priority, not entitlement. So as you get closer to that 18, it's as Scott said, you're in the day-to-day. You're trying to live. There's no holiday. There's no date night. There is nothing that can't happen unexpectedly. But think about that age 18. So I understand from so many of you who have been kind enough to share some of your experience with me. So most of you are going to be looking at the need for a guardianship. So under every state scheme, and I'll speak mostly from the citations I have here from Maryland law, but those statutes that govern guardianship are found in an article within your codes in individual states that are under a state and trust, and it's going to be administered by maybe an orphan's court, which seems rather crazy, but that's where we humans planted it. And there'll be a whole scheme of rules and regulations and statutes that tell us how to get there. For overall planning purposes, estate planning, very important. I know you all do think about this, but this would be a good time if you haven't already. Start an organizational system that makes sense for you. Those lovely D-ring binders that are incredibly resilient, I can tell you they have fallen off of a colleague's car driving from his home to the office, and I can tell you that they did not fall apart when they landed on the road. So, true story. So you can have a binder, for example, for your IEP materials. Have a binder for your assessments. Start a binder for your estate documents. Those would be everything from your advance directives to your powers of attorney. And it's your planning instrument that should be revised every several years or with major changes. Special needs trusts. For those who are able to get to counsel, and they are very complex instruments to draw, it's not within my scope of practice, as the lawyer would say it, but they are a means by which, again, you can plan ahead and fund that special needs trust with money that allows that for usage, transportation, health, residence, a place to live, health care, legal fees, whatever the case may be. The important part is it is not a means-controlled tool. In other words, your child can continue to receive SSI, for example, your supplemental security income. That's means-tested. The child, the individual, cannot have more than $2,000 in assets, whereas a special needs trust, for example, if families want to give cash gifts, the special needs trust would be a good place to put those. That way, when you apply for SSI for your child, the means test focuses on everything else that's there, bank accounts, stocks, bonds, all of that cannot exceed $2,000, whereas those items can be used to fund the special needs trust. ABLE account. Many of the states have taken the lead that the federal government started. The ABLE was passed in 2014. It is another mechanism, another tool that is not means dependent. Maryland instituted the ABLE account legislation in 2016. It's coming to fruition for implementation a little bit later this year. So with an ABLE account, the individual needs to be no older than 26. Because it's not means tested, meaning there are few limits and it's not dependent upon and it doesn't impact SSI, for example, those funds can be used for health, residence, physician fees, legal services, expenses directly attendant to your child or adult child. The maximum per year is the gift amount under federal law, so that's $14,000. So check your local resources. The Attorney General's office, I found that the Maryland website is very handy. If you go to that in your home state, you'll find a lot of information, which includes information about guardianship, special needs trust a little bit. Your state bar association, we actually do some good things. So if you go to your website in your own state, put in Minnesota State Bar Association, Wyoming State Bar Association, whatever it is, and click through. There are going to be some very helpful links. I know in Maryland there are, about guardianship, some of these other tools. Here's the big core of what you all are looking at. And again, that magic marker is 18, because at 18, the law presumes the individual to be competent, to be able to make the decisions about food, clothing, safety, all of those adult things that are human. So for those individuals who are not able to make those decisions voluntarily, who are not able to take in information, process, make an informed decision, and to make informed consent, that's the beginning of the analysis for whether a guardianship is needed. And from what I understand, most of you are in that position of being planful and making sure you have a guardianship in place. Because if you don't, and it's not to say that it can't be done after age 18, not my point at all, but by being ahead of that 18 mark, you'll have one less thing to worry about. So checklist your binders, your organization, and knowing that you have everything handy when you need it. And this is the piece that's so important. Power of attorney, advance directive. So for you as parents, your estate planning should include, you're not only thinking about what happens to your child when you're gone, but your own power of attorney. Who can step in for you if help is needed? And what do you want as your decisions at end of life? So these are things for you to think about. And yeah, it's a lot. So I have found over time, and I think families are good at figuring out the priorities. You can only do so much one day. You can only do so much at any one given time. So depending on the age of your child, again, use that organizational system to say, at the end of this year, I want to accomplish this. 2 years from now, so you can check those off. And in your home states, there's always the question of, well, who do I go to? Whether it's a neuropsychological, occupational therapy, drawing a will, a special needs trust. So yeah, you can find out a lot online. And usually it's the bad news that travels first, which is not such a bad thing. But your places of worship, the places where you go for support, your local conferences, everybody will generally have some good referrals, and those you can check out. And one of the things that I want to be able to leave you with is, because of having tools, you now have information and resources to share with others. Surrogate decision making, this is a good place to pause for a sec. So in Maryland, and I imagine in other states as well, if you don't have a guardian in place, if there's not a power of attorney in place, and a situation comes up where a major medical procedure or an end-of-life decision is required, Maryland has a statute, and you'll see the link there, but again, every state's going to have something very similar, whereby an individual can fill out an affidavit. So that means it has to be authorized, and there's specific language in each state. And you'll see, if you ever had a document notarized, you go to your bank, lawyers have, we have those in our offices, but it's an affirmation under oath, true to the best of my knowledge, under penalty of perjury. It means don't lie, and if you do, you could be penalized under law. The point of the surrogate affidavit is to say, this is who I am, I'm of age. I've known Sally Stanfield for a long time. I know that she wants to live robustly, and I know that she's quite independent, and I know that she doesn't want extraordinary life-sustaining procedures. And in that affidavit, the surrogate would be reciting also, I know her interests. I've known her for this many years. We have discussed these types of decisions. So getting that statement notarized, and if there's not a parent, if there's not a spouse, if there's not an adult child, and those emergency procedures or end-of-life decisions have to be made, surrogate decision-making with that signed affidavit, when there's no other written tool, is the path by which that individual can hand that to the attending physician or physicians that will go in the patient's file, and that decision will be honored as the wishes of the person we're talking about, of Sally's wishes at end of life. So these, again, these are going to be governed by individual rules in each of your states, but the core of it's the same. It's a decision rendered by someone who knows me when I'm not able to make decisions for myself. Okay. So at age 18, that whole concept of HIPAA, you keep running into it. It's important, and yes, it becomes very painful. So the good part about HIPAA is it prevents disclosure to third parties that are not authorized in advance by the person who holds the privilege. My medical records are mine. My background is mine. All of my personal identifying data is mine. Can't be disclosed unless I give prior written consent. At age 18, you're looking at children who probably cannot make that decision for themselves. Legal capacity, legal competency is the core of why families seek a court order that their child, now adult child, and it could be a child under 18, need a guardianship. A guardianship is last resort. It means that your child is not able to look at a set of facts, not able to take in information and make an informed, voluntary decision. It means that a less restrictive alternative, such as a power of attorney, advance directive, just not gonna work. It means you've looked at all other alternatives, and it means your child's gonna need support. And the way we look, one way to phrase it, and I like what the American Bar Association, which, by the way, does have some really good guidance on decision trees for how to do this. So they use the acronym PRACTICAL. And I have it up here. I'll share it with you and give you the link. But the important part about it is you're looking at whether your child can make decisions with support. I think for most of you, the answer is going to be your child does need a lot of support. So, rules, statutes, and it's designed to protect the individual because we're taking away a lot of just basic decision making. Yeah, we're talking about safety. We're talking about well-being. We're talking about providing needed services, taking care of medical, all of those things. But it's still a limitation. So if we're gonna put limits on someone, we gotta provide due process. And due process, good grief, I was in law school and I kept hearing this, it's the process that it's due. Well, that's really about the size of it. And the bigger, you're also gonna hear lawyers say, well, it depends. And you're probably gonna hear me say that today. It sounds ludicrous and sort of a cop-out, but I can tell you that everything we as lawyers do is about the facts and how they fit into the law. So the answer does really depend. And I invite you as we move forward, make it interactive. So when you have questions, don't feel like you have to save them. Because this is about you today, not about me standing up here and making sure I tell you everything, because it's a big topic. So if we're gonna put limitations on due process, and we're talking about someone who is wired differently, where chromosomes replicated differently, and the impact is a big deal on life. So you love your kiddos. That's why you're here. So you wanna make sure you've got it in place, and you wanna make sure it's done right. So when you go down the road of starting with a guardianship, here's what you need to think about. First of all, are you in a position to do it? And generally my clients, it's been both parents. So the fiduciary duty, you will hear time and again, whether it's in the financial industry, your doctors, it's that confidentiality, it's that privilege, doctor, patient, lawyer, client. And the fiduciary duty is, I owe a duty to my clients. The guardian owes a duty to, and the disabled individual is what the courts will say. You might hear the courts say, alleged disabled person before there's actually court findings. But the guardian owes a fiduciary duty, and that is the prudent person making reasonable decisions that you would make for yourself for those very important things of human living. It's reasonable care, what the prudent person would do. It's honesty, it's good faith. And your job is to protect, which you do anyway, your child, and whatever assets your child has. It goes without saying, but again, if we're going to put these kinds of limitations through the courts and say, okay, your child needs a guardianship, then we're going to impose a duty. So when you file the petition, and each state, Maryland certainly, there's a statutory form. And by that, I mean, there literally is a form you can fill out, you print it, you can fill it in, or in any event, you create your own, which is good, what lawyers are good at doing, we make a template. But what you have to make sure is include all the biographical information. The total goal of that petition is to demonstrate to the court that your child needs a guardianship and that no other family supports, power of attorney, advance directive, surrogate, whatever it is, it's not enough. The court is the one that makes the decision on the validity of the guardianship petition. In Maryland, and I'm sure in other states, there's enough for all of them. There is a right to a jury trial. And that will prevail. That will be, the hearing will be set down, as we say it, for a full hearing with the jury, unless the disabled person and their attorney waives that jury. Now, the cases I've had, one actually went to trial, went to hearing, but it was to a judge. None of the guardianships I've been involved have included a full hearing because there's been agreement about the need for the individual we're talking about. So anyone who is an interested party can be the petitioner. And it's a long document. It's age, name, where does Sally live? Sally lives with her parents, and I'll just keep referring to myself. I live at X address with my parents. I have two siblings. Their names are, their ages are. My grandparents are. I have, I'm receiving benefits. So other interested persons are gonna be Social Security Administration because of the supplemental security income. Every state, something on the order of a Developmental Disabilities Administration, DDA. They're also an interested party. Social Services. Social Services is named because there's always going to be a family where something, I mean, your lives are full of something happening. So if parents are unable to be a guardian for whatever reason, and I'm working with a family right now with an adult child, just aren't in a position to be a guardian. Perhaps there are no other family members nearby, or no one's available regardless, able to do it. So Social Services, Department of Social Service in your respective state, they're the other interested party who would step in, and then it would be a public guardianship. Yes, ma'am. So what I would do in that situation, and it's where estate planning for you individually and for your family, have a plan of succession in place so that part of that transition from closing your estate, you're going to make provisions for your children in any event. Great idea. Thanks. So this way, you have a plan. The families I work with today, both parents are guardians. So one would step in for the other. Beyond that, you can make that provision in your will. And then what would need to be happening is to notify the court. Once you have a guardianship, everything is kept in an account. So again, you're back to your organization. You keep a ledger, you have a checkbook, you know where your expenses are going. You have an inventory of your child's assets, and becomes more important as they get older. So if there's a change in who the guardian is because of a will situation and a death, or whatever, someone's not able to serve, you go back into court, you file in court, and let the court know on paper, called pleadings, that this has occurred. And unless there's a reason that signals to the court, there is a reason to set this on for a formal hearing, it will continue on. But in all of it, the court's knowing what's going on is the guardian's responsibility, okay? All right. So your interested persons, any of those people can file for a petition. And again, generally it's been the parents who have come to me. And in that petition, we're gonna lay out all the interested persons, and we're going to say that I, Sally, have been diagnosed with X disabling conditions that preclude me from having capacity, competency. And I say those two words with the greatest of respect. It's legal capacity, it's legal competency. And it goes back to the ability to take in information, process it, make an informed decision. If I can't do that, for all of those activities of life, the important parts of being human, then I do need a guardian. So that is the core of why you look hard at who's gonna be the guardian. So in the rest of the petition, you will also include as attachments, start to move forward, two verifications from qualified experts. Psychologist, PsyD, and some PhyD. I'm sure you're familiar with all the initials, or a PhD. And it's a difference in clinical experience and additional work. One psychologist, and the other verification can come from two medical doctors. Let's back up. So two medical doctors, or psychologist and medical doctor. Psychologist, licensed clinical social worker, or some combination, MD and one of the others. The important part about those two verifications, the expert's experience. I graduated from X school in 1978. I've been in the practice for X number of years. I have examined Sally. I have found the following conditions to be present. Because of these conditions, Sally is unable to make decisions about food, lodging, medical, and therefore needs a guardian. And again, that is set forth under statute. It will be in every state. And those two verifications have to be filed with the original petition for guardianship. The verifications both need to be current. So current, definitely at least no more than 9 to 12 months old. One of them for sure, and it doesn't matter which one, whether from a medical doc, the clinical social worker, or the psychologist. One of them has to be dated within 21 days. And this is in Maryland, so again, it's a local statute issue where you live. But it has to be dated within 3 weeks of when you file. And if it's one day off, the clerk of court's gonna send it back to you. And then you gotta go back to the physician or psychologist and get it dated. And he or she will need to see the individual again. And it's for the protection of the individual. It's the due process, it's getting it right the first time. So in that petition, I also ask on behalf of the parents, my clients, what relief they want. So the verifications are there. They want to be appointed guardians because their son or daughter's unable to make these important decisions. They want to be appointed as temporary guardians pending the final hearing. They don't want to have to post bond because the court can, if it's a corporation, if it's a public guardianship, then you're going to have the Department of Social Services involved to ask to be guardian, they may have to post bond. But the court has the authority to waive it. So parents, we want that to be waived so they do not have to put the additional money down. And then I'm also going to ask on behalf of the family to appoint an attorney on behalf of their child. The reason being for that, you don't want someone double dipping. It's a conflict of interest. And in all of this, it's to protect you as parents, but it's also to protect your child. So you're going into court and asking for an extraordinary remedy because it's needed. So the court will appoint an attorney to represent your child. Best interest of the child always rules, whether under 18 or over 18. Again, because it's a very important mechanism, it has a lot of limiting factors on your child's independence. So when an attorney is appointed, it could come from various sources. It could come from a panel of attorneys, and that's generally what I have found. So I have filed in a couple of different counties here in Maryland, and there's a group of lawyers who have their names on a list with the court that has jurisdiction. In Maryland, it's the Circuit Court. In Washington State, it's Superior Court, whatever it is. And that panel of lawyers provide the choices for the judge. And they all have experience with guardianship. They've all been doing it for a long time. They're known to the local judges. And this is where it matters who you choose for counsel, because you want somebody who knows your jurisdiction. You're going to be operating in the county where you live, and more importantly, the county where your child lives. The court of residence has jurisdiction. So the panel attorney will be appointed. Those are the early things that we ask for in the petition. That's filed, and the court will then issue what we call a show cause order. The petition is mailed, and I use certified mail, so you get a receipt back. Again, it's paper trail, it's verification. So that petition's going to be mailed out to grandparents, siblings, Department of Social Services, your DDA. Those are individuals that will have notice. Within 20 days, they have to respond back to the court whether they have any disagreement with the guardianship. That is the show cause order. The court issues that order and says to me as the lawyer, you mail a petition, you mail the show cause order to all of these interested parties. Interested parties, you have 20 days, or it could vary in your own states, to let me, the judge, know whether you object to this individual having a guardian. So again, all of this is dependent on timelines, and you have to make the timelines. Yes, ma'am.
Having this in place, do you think it's really important to start the process when the child is 17 or 17 and a half, or do you think it matters to start when they're 18?
I would start it earlier rather than later, because here's the thing. In practical terms, you're still going to be able to do pretty much what you need to. You go to your IEP meetings. Your doc, probably the child's physician, will handle individuals who are 18, 19, 20, and probably 21. That's been my experience with family physicians, psychiatrists. They probably will. But I think in terms of ease of mind and getting something in place, because if something happens, then you don't have to worry about it. But I've certainly had families who have come to me when their children are over 18. But what you do run into could be a physician who says, I get it, but I can't treat your child with you in the room. I can't let you make medical appointments. You can't see his or her records, whatever it is. So yes, I would start it earlier. So the question was, what age do I suggest, recommend? 17 is fine, 16. And I've had clients over the years, some have come in far earlier with a great deal. of need on their child's part. So for all of you, you know, I think you can time it with funds, whether, and I would suggest, you know, attorneys are not be all end all. I'm just one person. We're not inexpensive. That would be beyond, yeah. But in terms of timing it so it's affordable, timing it when you have the time to deal with a lawyer, your child's best interest lawyer coming into your home, because that individual's gonna come, that other attorney's gonna come into your home, take a tour, sit with your child without your being there. It's gonna ask a lot of questions. It's gonna look at the kitchen. Where's your child's bedroom? Can I see your checkbook? Are you receiving SSI for your child? Okay, if you are, can I see those accounts as well? Do you report on time? Let me see your child's IEP, all of that. And depending on what's going on in your life, may not be something you want to deal with right then. And as long as your child's under 18, you as parents are stakeholders, you're legal guardians, you love your children, you know more about them than anybody else on the planet. So really, until age 17, you're probably fine. You're good. What I would do is make sure your own will documents are up to date. And here I am, the farmer's daughter, as I still say, or the cobbler's kid has no shoes. So I need to update my own will. But when you've got children involved who are minors, truly, wills need to be in place. There needs to be a plan of succession. There needs to be review of those every 5 years, or when there's a major life event, a new birth, a divorce, a marriage, a death, somebody moves out of state, whatever it is. And those are priorities that really should be attended to. And as long as your child's under 18, you can prioritize what makes the most sense, both in terms of time and money. What you don't want to be caught in is a position where you don't have a will, and then there's a lot of guesswork, and family members are scrambling to figure out what's going to happen. And you love your children beyond words, so also have that plan in place. So if something happens, you already have in place who's going to step in. Okay. Best interest attorney. So in Maryland, when there is a petition filed and that best interest attorney is appointed, the parents who have come to me for these proceedings are usually the ones who pay the attorney fees for the best interest attorney. It's going to differ in every state. It's important to know. So it's another piece to plan for. It's an understanding of the fact that it's an extraordinary tool that you're asking the court to award, which is a guardianship, and it's not inexpensive. So in terms of whether you need counsel, it's always about resources. It's always about money. You have a lot on your plate. You deal with a lot of healthcare providers, evaluators. It's always something. The rules in every state, and certainly in Maryland, they're very detailed. They're very time-oriented. The process can take as little as maybe a few months, and by that I mean 3-4 months. More like it's going to be 6 to 9 realistically. So making sure that the petition is filed, that you have that 21-day fresh verification, that you get the notices out to interested parties, that you have return receipts, because you don't have to file in Maryland the return receipts, but you better have them if there's a question. Maryland certainly does, I suspect other states as well. You have to serve the petition on your child, be child or adult. Well, that seems disingenuous, except for the fact it's the process that's due. So you'll need to think about who that petition can be served upon who's not living in your household. So if you have an adult child in college, They can take service if they wish. If the child has an aunt, an uncle, if you have a sibling, a parent, whether down the street in another county or in state, and I've actually had an aunt take service out of state, that's fine. It's just got to be somebody who's not in the household. And again, it's for the protection of your child and the due process that's important. One of the benefits of having the best interest attorney, and you have people who do these processes, it matters to them for you as families who have these challenges. So the best interest attorney is someone who I see this is coming, and I've been over in that court enough, and I know who the panel attorneys are, so he and or she and I can talk ahead of time and say, I filed this. And the one fellow I work with in another county a couple of times, he says, yeah, why don't you put my name in on the petition and ask for appointment? Happy to do that, and if the judge appoints me, great. If not, it'll still work. So that has occurred. But when I get the show cause order back, which includes who's been appointed, I pick up the phone, I call so-and-so, and I say, hi, this is Sally Stanfield, I represent. Would you take service of the petition for guardianship? Absolutely. And then I say, so what else do you need? Well, I need the IEP. Do you have any evaluations? Yes, I do. So I'll call the parents. I'll say, just spoke to so-and-so. They've been appointed. Good person. I think we're going to have a good working relationship. I'm going to provide the IEP. I'm going to provide these evaluations. Are you okay with that? Absolutely. So I send them over. I also ask the parents, are you okay if I give them your contact information? Yep, go ahead. So we streamline it. And from what I'm learning from all of you, which I greatly appreciate, is you're going to need to go down this road. So by having all these documents in an organized fashion, those can be transmitted with relative ease. Get the best interest attorney in, and they're going to need to make at least once one visit, and probably twice. The fellow I work with has done this for years in his home court. So he's contacted my clients, the parents, and said, this is what I'm doing. I represent your child. I spoke with your attorney. I'd like to make an appointment. When can I come over and see you? So that person's going to come to your home. And as I mentioned, have a long conversation with you and meet your child and see the surroundings. Report back to the court. Now, the court can also appoint a separate investigator. But if you have an attorney who understands the process and who understands the world of challenge that comes with disabilities at all places along the spectrum, if you will, then that person's going to know the questions to ask, how to report back to the court. I love supervisors. And can work with the parents. So the goal of this type of approach is that if there can be consensus prior to a hearing, you can imagine things are going to go much more smoothly. It lowers your angst as a parent. It lowers your family's angst. And it minimizes the exposure for your child. So when it comes time, so now you've done all this work through your attorney, all this documentation has been shared, and up to this point, no one's had to go to court because it's all been done electronically, courier filing, whatever it is. So now the hearing date's been set, and generally that's been 4 or 5 months down the road. So before I've gotten there, I've called that same attorney back. I said, do you really see an issue with this? The cases I've had to date, all but one, no. So that means on the day of court, you still got the angst and you're taking on a great deal of responsibility, but you have consensus. And what that means is that best interest attorney can stand up on your child's behalf and say, Your Honor, I've been to the home, not once, but twice, the second time being just last week or 2 days ago. I've walked through the home. I've met everyone. I've spent time with my client. I've seen the reports. My recommendation, Your Honor, is that this individual really does need a guardianship and that your petitioners, who counsel represents, are really qualified and they will do it honestly, in good faith, and with prudence. And we agree with the need for guardianship. We ask the court to enter that order. So in that kind of hearing, it's only the judge. They will have waived, and I would have discussed that with the attorney ahead of time. Do you want a jury? Do you want a trial? No, we agree. Okay. So you're talking a relatively short appearance, and you're talking a modest total attorney fee bill. So yeah, that family's gonna have my fees to pay as well as the best interest attorney. But in terms of the angst and the turmoil, because you've done your homework ahead of time, it goes pretty well. So for those cases where you have a family dispute, think back to what I mentioned with the acronym PRACTICAL a while ago. So there's always gonna be, and mostly this is for information for you to carry forward and share with others. But there's always gonna be cases where it's a close call. And you have to look at, can this individual make decisions with support? And what does that support look like? It's also born of knowing the judges you go in front of. And I've been in front of a judge in the one instance where there was a huge family dispute. And this is what you need to be aware of. Probably it's not going to be applicable here, I suspect. But families and humans do argue. And when it comes to individual rights, it's huge. So we had a dispute on a guardianship. The family was split. We went to court. What we didn't know was that the judge had some real personal experience with a very challenged member of the family. So next to that member of the family, there was no way that the adult child was going to be approved for guardianship. The adult child was simply too able. And I know in hindsight that was absolutely the case. I really got that. Question? Good question. So the question is, if the child thinks he or she is more able than what the reports and what the experts would say, what do you do? So this is where the acumen of the lawyers and input from the families and looking at the overall circumstances and also what your pain point is for the angst and your wallet. So in terms of that acronym PRACTICAL, assessing what decisions the individual is able to make with support. What is impacting those decisions? Is there a physical ailment? Is there a flu on board? Is there chronic diabetes and there isn't appropriate nutrition, or maybe there's not a good medication protocol on board to manage the diabetes? Is there some other physical condition that impairs the decision-making that can otherwise be treated? Are there community supports from parents who come in to discuss? Can it be phrased in a way to get through to that adult child? In other words, is there a conversation with third parties? Because you all know, I know, parents don't know anything when we're kids. So a kiddo who's on that borderline of need and ability to consent, it's gonna be pretty darn sure he or she knows it all. So is there a third party with the acumen, the experience, who can talk to that individual and say, look, I know, I get it. You don't want anybody telling you what to do. You're an adult, you wanna control your life, or even if you're 15, you know enough, and some at 13 know way too much. But is there a conversation with someone who can talk through, well, if I do this, and I give you all this information, tell me what you would do. And then you run through a bunch of scenarios and say, if I do this, and if this, and if this, what would you do? So you're gonna have to rely on experts, and you're gonna have to rely on a lot of conversation with the lawyers involved, and then you're gonna have to make a decision whether the internal angst and your financial ability is going to permit a contested hearing. And in the preparation for making that determination, there's so many good clinicians out there And again, finding those through your network of friends, wherever it is that you go during your life. I phrased it to a 19-year-old at one point, I think you need an ally. Does that sound about right? Yeah. You need somebody to help you make decisions. Yeah, that's okay. And if you got confused, what would you do? Well, okay, so suppose you went to your mom or dad or your aunt. How's that sound? Yeah, I can do that. So those are the ways you can kind of back into it. It's really being creative. Because really, we're asking the judge with these orders to make that determination, especially if it's a close call. So you're going to need a lot of expert input anyway. So if that individual can sit with a counselor, great. Now, what happens if there's absolutely a stone wall? I'm not going to sit with so-and-so. I'm not going to sit with Miss Sally. Forget it. I don't want a guardian. I know what I'm doing. So now you're going to look at utilizing court resources, depending on what the level of impairment is. So there's two ways to parse that. If you have experts who are saying that the individual needs a guardian, and that individual is saying, no, I don't, that's one set of circumstances. But if you have experts who are saying he or she doesn't need a guardian, but you know they need help, then you have to back into that decision by utilizing a decision tree with if this, then that, finding someone who can talk to your child. But you got to start with the experts, and that's where it gets hard. Because if you don't have an expert who's willing to say that these diagnosed disabling conditions preclude voluntary competent decision making, then there's no judge that's going to see a need for a guardianship. And then your life as a parent is going to be really complicated, obviously. But guardianship, and again, it's getting it in place before 18, especially where you've got this close call individual. Guardianship will provide a barrier to your kiddo signing a contract. And I have an individual in mind who was prone to this, very vulnerable to a peer saying, hey, let's go buy this, let's go buy that. And next thing you know, your son or daughter signed off on a really cool car. So if you've got if you have a guardianship, that transaction can be voided. If you have a power of attorney, not so easy, but at least you have a document in place. So I hear your worry. So as you're moving forward, have these conversations with your providers. If you've got a situation where it's going to be a close call, start talking to people. I would seek counsel where you live. I would talk to your physician, psychologist, and see what you have. Get some experts involved who maybe your kiddo would sit with, because that's a big one. It turns into legal liability in circumstances you do not want to have to deal with. It's really scary. And here's the other thing. You'll notice this burden of proof line up here. So we've all heard about beyond a reasonable doubt. So lawyers operate in the world of evidence in three different levels. Beyond a reasonable doubt is the highest burden, and that's when you're going to impose the highest limitation, either with life or liberty. That's why it's used in the criminal system or in the juvenile system. At the least restrictive, intensive level, if you will, is a preponderance of the evidence. So if you imagine a scale, the word scintilla comes to mind. So if it's a hair's breadth heavier than 50% and that scale tilts that hair's weight, that's a preponderance. So it doesn't have to be much more than half persuaded, just a little bit more. So what we do with guardianship, because it's a pretty big deal, it is a big deal decision. So the court has to be satisfied by clear and convincing. Well, what the heck is clear and convincing? Well, dictionary will tell you what those words mean, but in practical terms, it's why we have legislated two physician verifications and decision making that the individual can't make without a lot of assistance, impairment due to diagnosed disabling conditions, for the very basics of human life: safety, health, food, and shelter. So clear and convincing, judge has to be sure about that. if even if you come in with agreement among the parties, still has to be that same burden. The judge may not say it out loud on the record, but you know, going in, you have to dot the I's, cross the T's. And if you go to full hearing, a trial, that means the individual's going to be there with his or her lawyer. I'm going to be there with the parents. We carry the burden of proof because we're asking for the guardianship. So I have to put on two experts who signed off on the verifications. And then I have to put on the parents or whoever is going to do better on the stand. And our goal is to show the guardianship is needed, that the individual can't make competent, voluntary, informed decisions, simply is unable to, and then meet that clear and convincing standard. It's a pretty high one. It's higher than what you would do as a matter of reasonable decision. So it's reasonable to wear a raincoat when you know what the weather's gonna do. Clear and convincing is gotta be pretty daggone sure. You gotta have the facts that my child is that level of need impaired because of disabling conditions. And you better convince me with expert documentation. So what you want out of all this, whether it's an agreed upon hearing where you have consensus or you get a verdict, you want an adjudication. You want the judge to look at all of this, or if there's actually a jury trial, same difference. You want the finder of fact to say, okay, by clear and convincing, you've convinced me. Need guardianship. And that guardian's gonna be appointed. And for the most part, I think courts will go with two guardians. They prefer one guardian, but I think when you've got two parents, courts will probably do that. And you need to check with your own jurisdiction. Guardianship is what it is. It does not remove any other civil right. So it cannot become a basis to commit someone to a psychiatric facility, for example. If your kiddo wants to vote, take in information, doesn't take away a voting right. There's no other civil rights that are removed unless the court says so. In terms of what happens when that person or persons, will just say the parents are appointed as guardians, first thing you end up doing is filing an inventory with the court within 60 days. It says, this is what my child has, and here's the report. Back to that binder organization. Every bill, it's kind of like just keeping what you do for your personal income taxes or business income taxes. Have that all segregated, separate ledger. Separate account for your child's expenses. You need to have that anyway to take the SSI or the SSDI payments that come to you. All that has to be segregated. Every year, the annual report gets filed with the clerk of court. Be on time. If you're not, you're going to hear about it. Some courts may or may not send out notices. It's your obligation to get it there on time. The year ticks off from the day the order was signed. So if an order were signed today, my report back to the court 1 year from now, on the dot, no later. The forms are available with the clerk that manages the court in your county for filing all of these. There's a form for everything. And the clerks are actually very helpful. They won't give you, and they will tell you, I can't give you legal advice. But there's a lot of forms. You generally don't need a lawyer for that filing. And in any event, your State Bar Association website, as I mentioned, and your attorney general in your local state. So you file these reports with the clerk of court. Keep a copy for yourself. That goes into your records. When you go in to file it, make sure you have the clerk's stamp received. You've heard that one before. So you take your stamp received home, you file it. The clerk is going to send it up to the assigned judge, and all these judges rotate through. Some will be in juvenile court for a while, somebody else is going to be in family court for a while, a couple somebodies, and it is usually several judges, somebody else and a couple somebodies will be doing the estate trust court. So that's going to be will administration and guardianships. So that judge is going to have a stack of stuff on his or her desk with a clerk who's probably a law student. A lot of places use staff attorneys. But anyway, that is your gatekeeper for getting things to the judge. So the clerk's going to read through everything and say, hey, Your Honor, this looks like we're in good shape. I don't see anything that suggests that the guardianship should change. Judge will sign off. End of story till the following year. One of the things, so aside from the broad fiduciary duty for the guardian, a couple of things have happened in the last couple of years which won't surprise you. One of the things that the trust, the guardian, must do is make sure that when visitors want to see the individual, your child, they can get in. So that means visits, there's a right to email, there's a right to snail mail. And as you would imagine, if somebody wants to get in to visit and they're being barred for whatever reason, then the interested person, or for that matter, the person who has the guardian, can file. Go back to your local court where that individual lives, and there is a set of steps. And if it goes to hearing, it goes to hearing. But you can litigate where there's no access by mail, communication, or visitors. That's how important self-determination is. And that's why a lot of these barriers that you run into are seemingly lack of funds. It's about self-determination. It's entitlement when your child's in school. And afterwards, it's priority and self-determination. But again, the guardian has to make sure about health, well-being, recreation, friends, to the extent possible. Big topic, questions.
Here. I'm in the process of working through this in Massachusetts, but I was wondering if we happen to move, what happens to the guardianship, especially if we are, say my child's 30 years old at that point. And the second question would be, we have a special needs trust for her, and the same question, it's through a lawyer in Massachusetts. How would that transfer to another state?
Great question. As you recall from your days with IEPs, you want everything portable so that people move for various reasons. So if and when you were to move, those guardianship papers need to be filed in your local county where you will be living. So it will be an expense to get to counsel. Same thing with special needs trust. But I would recommend that it's worth the money for a consultation. And most attorneys are really good about a reasonable fee for a consultation. Find out what you need to know. And it's what you don't know that's going to get you in trouble. But those are legal documents that have to be filed in court. And for those of you who aren't familiar with special needs trusts, they are such spectacularly complex instruments that there aren't very many attorneys who practice in that area. Moreover, they have to be filed with the Secretary of State where you live and approved. So that attorney will actually keep the letter of approval on file that the Secretary of State has issued. So yeah, I would transport this all. And when you file for guard, it'll mean probably another filing, but then one of the questions will be, have you ever had a guardianship in another state? Yes, I have those papers attached.
Other questions? Is there a question back here? I'll go here and then back to Kelly.
Go, Scott, go.
What's the difference between the POA and guardianship?
Okay, the power of attorney, and there's actually two kinds of power of attorney. Let me back up a little bit. So a power of attorney is a delegation of responsibility from the principal. So we'll say it's my power of attorney. I am delegating to someone, Scott, the authority to make decisions on my behalf. And it could be in the healthcare medical domain or in a separate instrument, financial. That would take effect whenever there is a need, but it means you'd have to activate it first. And each state has its statutory language. So it reads like lawyerese, but a lot of states in Maryland's one where you have particular language that you have to file. To avoid that, You want to use a durable power of attorney. That means it takes effect right then at signature and notarization, but you as the principal, I, Sally, retain all of my decision-making until I can't. And then it's a seamless movement into my agent, Scott, making decisions on my behalf for medical procedures, appointments, whatever it is. Guardianship. It is a heightened level of responsibility, a heightened level of agency status. So your child, whether minor or adult, the child is not able to make informed, voluntary, consensual decisions, as in doesn't have legal capacity for those important things called food, shelter, safety, well-being. So guardians are now taking that responsibility from the disabled individual to assure safety, well-being, recreation, friends, healthcare, food, shelter, okay? And the guardian doesn't have carte blanche, by the way. So the guardian can do a lot to arrange for care, appointments, make decisions, but when there is a substantial risk of harm or withdrawal of treatment or withholding treatment, the guardian's got to go to court and file papers, and whether the judge sets it on for hearing is the phrase, whether the court orders a hearing is a separate question. But the guardian has to go to court, file papers, ask the court for permission for a procedure, substantial risk, or if treatment's gonna be withheld or withdrawn. And that makes sense because it's extraordinary. There's a big risk to health and life. If the individual is hospitalized or the individual dies, the guardian has to notify all interested parties. And if that happens, the guardian's got to go back into court, file papers, and ask that the guardianship be terminated. So those things don't magically go away. If there is a death, then you have to go back to court, okay?
Hi.
Hey.
So I just need some help. My daughter's 11, and I'm starting this process.
Okay.
But I just need, I guess if you could help us navigate the financial planning. It's a little bit overwhelming for me to budget for a lawyer,
right.
I think, for guardianship, and then a lawyer for like a special needs trust,
mm-hmm.
and maybe, I don't know if ABLE counts, we're gonna need a lawyer. But so what parts, is there anything that we can do like online
mm-hmm.
that, or with notaries and things, and what parts we absolutely have to have pro bono support, I guess, and how to navigate? What are the timelines, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
Is that too many questions?
Not at all.
Oh, sorry.
So how old's your child?
She is 11.
Okay, she's 11. So 17 is when I would really start worrying about, if you will, the guardianship feature. So right now, for any of these instruments and any of these processes you want to undertake, have a centralized organization for all of your evaluations, your IEPs. If your child's getting SSI or SSD, I have that available. The means testing for SSI requires no more than $2,000 to your child's name. So bank accounts, they gotta be under $2,000. So start thinking ahead. If your family wants to gift stocks, that's where the special needs trust, and that would be my first recommendation right now, because they are complex, they're costly. I wouldn't even, it's so not in my scope of practice because it wasn't where I wanted to be for one thing, but for another, it's a lot of specialization that's contraindicated for what I do. So in terms of protecting assets and taking care of your child for the future, and you can access those funds for legal fees, health, all of that, and again, it will not impact SSI payments. I'd go there first. And all of the planning you do in terms of family information, where they're located, updated addresses. Who's going to step in when you're not able to be a guardian or no longer living? The hard part, because you all, any parent worries about if you outlive your children, but then if you're not around, what's going to happen? So pre-planning with who's going to step in those hard conversations with your other children, your siblings, your parents, aunts, uncles, or people you trust who are not by blood family, so your family by choice. So special needs, SSI is a 17 or so year old child's application. That can be done online. I would recommend highly counsel for special needs trust, and if you have the means to fund it, absolutely. The ABLE is another mechanism that may be cost effective for your family, so seek counsel on that one. There are organizations that you can find online. I would vet them closely. I would reach out to your local organizations to say, who do you know that's supposedly providing services to craft these ABLE accounts? And actually, your special needs trust attorney can tell you about the ABLE. So there's a resource. In terms of your SSI application, unfortunately, we humans have really done it to ourselves. The amount of fraud that's out there has meant, in practical terms, that Social Security supplemental is a really hard, long process. What I've done, and I haven't done many of them, but the one pretty impaired individual, but still a lot of ability. But what we did was front load it. So with all that you're doing, the more planning, the more information you have up front, same thing with your best interest attorney. Everything there and ready to go. So what we did on the SSI, and again, this is when your child's turning 17, all the evaluations, the child's assets are under that 2000 mark, and they're going to want to see your child. So you do the application online. You and your child, and we really were fortunate. We had a case manager because my client was actually in a voluntary placement situation. So the case manager for that voluntary placement came with us to the SSI interview. And there's no more powerful testimony than your child being him or herself. So as able as my guy was, he really did need the guardianship. And moreover, he needed the SSI. So we had all of that information, and I gave the representative from Social Security Administration a stack of stuff like this, and she looked at me. It's all yours. So they don't have to send out signed authorizations to get records from every doc, physician, school that this child's ever attended. And we said, and here's the bank account statements. Assets way under 2,000. Okay. So that child was approved for SSI. I can tell you the rarity of that is unreal. However, persevere. If you get turned down, appeal, reapply. Because what's happening is if they don't have the information, which includes the diagnosed disability is not clear enough, it's not clear enough that the child can't maintain, that the young adult can't maintain substantial gainful employment, and that there's too many assets, any of those three things are gonna cause a denial. So if you get all this together and you're honing everything for age 18, so special needs or ABLE, Social Security, guardianship at 17. So in terms of how to allocate your funds for guardianship, again, as I understand, most of the children whose parents are now, I have the pleasure of speaking to, probably looking at guardianship. So what you can do, get yourself a consultation just to make sure you've got everything taken care of. You can find the forms you need. There are pro bono attorneys or sliding fee. Just remember, you get what you pay for, and good networking is important. If you don't have the assets to pay for the best interest attorney, there can be an affidavit filed for the court to waive those fees, and those fees will be paid out of the public coffers. So being organized with all this information, knowing what your deadlines are, and you can get some good information from the websites we've talked about, you can be very prepared and cut your attorney's costs. It also may be where you can't actually manage it yourself, just knowing you want to get an affidavit in there if you truly can't afford the fees.